Thank you. morning, First Christian. We ask that you please stand and join us in singing our congregational hymn. Hello, hello, good morning, good morning.
Amen. Praise the Lord, church. It's good to see you in God's house. Welcome to First Christian Church. What a blessing it is to be able to be together in God's presence. There is no substitute for the house of the Lord, I feel like, in the community of God. It is a blessing to be together. And for those who are worshiping online, we welcome you as well. And I know that that's the best thing for some of us still, but I encourage you, wherever you're worshiping from, to prepare the space around you, to make that your sanctuary, to find the gift of community in some way, whether that's participating in the chat or texting somebody, or if you're here in person, in a moment I'll give you a chance to wave and blow kisses and whatever you want to do with those around you, as long as you stay where you are. It's a good blessing to be in the house of God together. I do want to share that we're having some little gremlins in our tech stuff, and so here in the sanctuary, they're saying we may have either audio or video, and so we chose audio. So there may be some things that don't show up on the screens, possibly. Just be patient. We're doing the best we can. They are doing the best they can, so wanted to warn you about that ahead of time so you don't look back there and go, what in the world's going on? They're doing their best. But right now, I want to encourage everyone to recognize the presence of God around you and maybe some surprising folks. If you would, say hello to somebody, shoot a text, send some love, blow a kiss, say hi to somebody, and let's all worship God together in this place.
Psalm 100 says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Will you pray with me? Father, we come before you this morning with praise for your goodness, for your provision, for the way that you provide a time and a space and a way that we can come and praise you with our songs, with our words, with our prayers, with our thoughts. We thank you, Father, that you are with us, that you love us, that your faithfulness and love endure for all generations. And we just praise you this morning as we say the prayer that Jesus taught us to say, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'm here with my friend Harper. You want to wave and say good morning? Okay, and we're sitting here. Actually, we have a package of M&Ms that we're going to talk about this morning. Okay, so do you want to dump those out on the paper towel? All right, good. We've got a big pile of M&Ms here. All right, so when you look at this pile of M&Ms, what do you see and what do you notice?
So I noticed that there is different colors about them, and they have all M's on them.
Okay, different colors, they have all M's. Anything else you notice about them?
They are, like, some of them are, like messed up, like this one.
Has a messed up M, mm-hmm.
And some of them have, like, bent edges just like this one.
Right, so they're different colors, they don't all look alike.
Yes.
Some of them have a really nice, pretty M. Some of them have messed up. Mm-hmm. So they're different. Would you agree with me if I said that no two of these M&Ms are the same? Like,
no.
Every one of them is different, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we're going to talk about how this package of M&Ms is like people, like you and me. All right. So first of all, you said that you noticed lots of different colors, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So would you agree that people come in all different colors?
Yes.
Yes. So we have all different races of people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You said that some of them have a really nice, pretty M on them, and then mm-hmm. some of them are kind of messed up. How could we relate that to people?
If you, like, if you, like, take away, like, half of the M,
mm-hmm.
like, those two lines, mm-hmm. and you make it, like, this one, it will turn out like this one,
mm-hmm.
and you're just going to have to block over with white to make a P.
Okay, so you could add some different lines and make it a different letter. Very cool. Yeah, I hadn't thought about that. So when we look on here and we see some of the M's are kind of messed up and some of them are really perfect. Do you ever have days where you feel like you're just kind of messed up?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then do you ever have days when you think, you know what, I'm doing pretty good today? Yeah. So mm-hmm. good days and bad days. Mm-hmm. We also all have different talents. Okay. Do you have something that you feel like you're talented at?
Gymnastics.
Gymnastics. What's your favorite thing about gymnastics?
That I get to meet my new teachers and that I get to get on all of this equipment.
All the equipment. Okay. So when we have people that have different colors of skin, maybe some of them are a little messier than others. Mm-hmm. Some of them have different talents. How do we make all of that work for God? Do you know?
So if you like have a different talent, you can like work on your talent to make it get better so you can be good like the pack.
Okay, yeah, and then we can use those talents for God, okay? Mm-hmm. Your talent is gymnastics. My talent is not gymnastics, so I would not be good at that at all. But there are other things that I feel like I'm good at that I could bring to use in a group of people that we could all work together and work for the same goal. Would you agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now let's take, okay, pick an M&M, whatever color you want, and let's see, tap it on the table. Are they hard or soft?
Hard.
Okay, now we're going to bite into one of them. Okay, so bite it. Okay, so what's on the inside of that M&M?
Chocolate.
Chocolate. Okay, is chocolate. Do you think chocolate is good? Mm-hmm. Okay, it's filled with some really good stuff. Okay, so what would happen or what would you think if you picked up one of these M&Ms and there was nothing in the middle of it?
I would just throw it on the floor.
Okay, you wouldn't think it was very good. Because M&Ms are supposed to have chocolate in the middle, right? It's not supposed to be just an empty shell. Well, you know what? We are supposed to be filled with God and His Spirit and His presence. So sometimes when we're having an icky day or we feel like we're having one of those times when we're a mess, then that's kind of like being an empty M&M. We're just kind of this hard, icky shell with none of the good stuff on the inside. Okay, so how do we make sure that we keep ourselves filled up with the good stuff of God?
If you like have candy or like any healthy or any like sweets or anything, mm-hmm. when you're done with your dinner, you can go in the pantry and get yourself one or two or three snacks.
Okay, all right, so that would fill up your belly, right? Mm-hmm. And then we'd be good and full.
Yeah.
Okay, so when we fill ourselves with God, we do it like by coming to church, right?
Mm-hmm.
Hanging out with our church friends, yes. Singing mm-hmm. and praying,
mm-hmm.
okay, all of those things. So when we're concentrating on filling ourselves with all the good things of God, and when we bring our talent, even when we're messy sometimes, and we put it all together, we can make beautiful things for God, right? Mm-hmm. Are you ready to pray? All right, here we go. Dear God, thank you so much for filling us with your love and with your Spirit. Help us to use our talents and our abilities to help people draw close to you and to enrich and bless the kingdom. Be with us this week. Help us to find those in need. Help us to use our talents for your good. Thank you for your love. We love you. Amen. Thank you, Harper.
Welcome.
Have a great week.
Amen. Thank you, Kristen, and thank you, Harper, for that wonderful lesson for us all. Do encourage you that if you are here in the sanctuary or there at home, go online to fccrogers.org and look for the prayer request tab there and share your joys and concerns with us in that way. We have a great prayer ministry that would love to pray with you and for you for the things that are going on in your life. And so I encourage you to do that not only today, but throughout the week. Anytime something comes up in your life that you would like extra prayer for, to share that. I do have a number of things to share with you. John Whitman continues to have dental problems and lots of pain in his mouth. And so those of you that are here this morning may have seen him out on the parking lot singing this morning. And then he was hurting so bad he decided to go on home. So continue to pray for him as he continues to have dental work and seek answers for that. We continue to pray for Sean McNabb as he continues to struggle to breathe, and the young man that's really struggling for his mom, Terry, as well. Continued prayers for Barbara Fugit and Cynthia Kaywood. Again, this past week, we had more mass shootings in our nation. And so we just pray for answers to end the violence, that we could seek peaceful ways to live with one another. We continue to pray for COVID as the numbers are starting to rise again, that we could all stay safe and everybody continue to wear your mask and stay socially distanced and get those vaccines and let's fight this as best we can, and to wrap that whole thing in prayer, asking God to work a miracle as well. For our hospital workers and everyone who's working with the pandemic, not only here in Arkansas, but around our nation. As always, we pray for the leaders of our nation and our world, for our troops and first responders, for all of those who are working so hard on our behalf. We pray with and for those of you at Innisfree that are watching there this morning. We are so grateful for you and glad that you can participate with us. We pray for Randy Graves, who is working to begin a Celebrate Recovery ministry here at First Christian Rogers, and that's set to begin on June the 2nd. He's put together a core team of people that are meeting and working hard to make that happen, and so pray for Randy and his team, and we pray thankful for all of you who have gathered here this morning to worship with us in person, and all of you at home and around watching online. We're glad to have you with us as well. I'm sure there are other things on your hearts and minds, so let's spend a few moments in silent prayer, and then I'll pray for us together. Let's pray. Almighty God, we have come into this place to sing your praises, to worship you, and to hear from you. And so we pray that your Holy Spirit would fill this place and every space where people are watching online, that you would break through our own distractions and speak to our hearts, that you would help us to understand who we are and how much we are loved. Oh God, we thank you for loving us, for loving us enough to save us from our sins. And so we confess today that there are times in our lives when we have gone against your will, when we have done things and said things that we know have hurt others and in turn hurt you. Oh God, we ask your forgiveness for those times and those ways. Oh God, we also ask that you would help us to learn to forgive one another, to learn to reach out to one another with grace and mercy. Oh God, we ask that you would help us to become more and more like Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. For we long to be a reflection of his grace and love in this world. God, we come today seeking to hear from you. So speak to us through this music, through the words that you've given to Pastor Sean, through the prayers and the quiet times. Break through in our lives. Do something new. Remind us of your love and power, of your grace and forgiveness. And send us out to change the world in your name and with your power. For this is our prayer in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
I've heard it said that people come into our lives for a reason, bringing something we must learn, and we are led to those who help us most to grow if we let them, and we help them in return. Well, I don't know if I believe that's true, But I know I'm who I am today because I knew you. Like a comet pulled from orbit as it passes the sun. Like a stream that meets a boulder halfway through the wood. Who can say if I've been changed for the better? Because I knew you. I have been changed for good.
It well may be that we will never meet again in this lifetime. So let me say before we part, so much of me is made of what I've learned from you. You'll be with me like a handprint on my heart. And now, whatever way our stories end, I know you have rewritten mine by being my friend. Like a ship blown from its mooring by a wind off the sea. Like a seed dropped by a sky bird in a distant wood. Who can say if I've been changed for the better? But because I knew you.
Because I knew you.
I have been changed for good. And just to clear the air, I ask forgiveness for the things I've done you blame me for.
But then I guess we know there's blame to share.
And none of it seems to matter anymore.
Like a
ship blown from its
moorings
by a wind off the sea.
Like a stream that meets
like a sea dropped by a
bird
in the
wood.
Who can say if I've been changed for the better? I do believe I have been changed for the better.
Because I knew you.
Because I knew you.
Because
I knew you.
I have been changed for good.
Amen. Thank you to Shane and Allison for that, and I assume Julia playing with them, but I couldn't tell if it was your fingers or not, but blessing. I encourage you to open your Bible if you brought your Bible, or if you've got it at home, open up your text and read along with me. We're going to read from the book of Acts, which is the story of the birth of the church and how the church begins and grows and the Spirit of God moves in those days after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so listen to these words, and I encourage you to hear in your soul what God is speaking to you through them. Acts chapter 3, beginning at verse 12. I'm going to come in the middle of this story and kind of leave it in the middle as well, but hear God's words for you. It says, when Peter saw that he had a congregation, he addressed the people, "O Israelites, why does this take you by such complete surprise? And why stare at us as if our power or piety made this man walk? The God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the God of your ancestors, has glorified his son Jesus. The very one that Pilate called innocent, you repudiated. You repudiated the Holy One, the Just One, and asked for a murderer in His place. You no sooner killed the Author of life than God raised Him from the dead. And we are the witnesses. Faith in Jesus' name put this lame man, whose condition you know so well, on his feet. Yes, faith and nothing but faith put this man healed and whole right before your eyes. And now, friends, I know that you had no idea what you were doing when you killed Jesus. And neither did your leaders. But God, who through the preaching of all the prophets had said all along that this Messiah, His Messiah, would be killed, God knew exactly what you were doing and used it to fulfill His plans. Now it's time to change your ways. Turn to face God so God can wipe away your sins, pour out showers of blessing to refresh you, and send you the Messiah He prepared for you, namely Jesus. This is God's word for God's people. Would you join me in a moment of prayer? Oh God, because we have met you in this place, we pray that you would change us for the good. God, reach into this space, reach into the rooms wherever we are, and reach into our broken and hurting bodies and touch with your power of presence. Touch with your power that brings life. Touch and bring words into us through our ears, through our thoughts, through our minds that change us and make us like you. Oh God, take me and use my voice, use my mind, my heart, my spirit, my soul, my body, for your preaching moment. God, I pray that you would move me aside and that this pulpit would be yours. Oh God, speak to all of us and make us like you. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ, in the Holy Spirit, all of God's people pray, and together we say, Amen. So earlier this week, I rolled up to this four-way stop right out here at the corner of 13th Street and Oak Street. And coming at me from the left was this mullet and plaid shirt clad driver in an old beater truck with a roaring exhaust system and Confederate flag stickers plastered everywhere. Now, I'll be honest with you, I judged that guy. We all do it, right? When we see a Democrat sign or we see a Republican sticker or somebody comes up and they're covered in tattoos or dressed in a certain way, we judge them. We assume that we know what that person will be like. Well, this guy pulled up to the stop just before me. And so I waited for him to rev up that big bad engine of his and go on his merry way. But I was surprised when he smiled kindly and waved me on. I believe that encounter illustrates the heart of our continued struggle with racism in this nation. You see, I believe that the vast majority of people here in the United States, the vast majority do not hate black folks, do not want to see them abused, don't believe that anybody should be treated differently. In that sense, we are not racist. However, here is our problem, my friends. When we see a black man reaching into his pocket, we make assumptions. When we see somebody with dark skin running in our gated community, our subconscious gives us feelings. When we pull over certain ethnicities late at night, we make judgments about them, who they are, what they believe, what they will do. We make judgments about them, judgments that we don't make about people that are of our own race. In that sense, racism is still alive and well in me and in our great nation. And that's pretty much what happens to Peter here in this text. Allow me to offer a little bit of the backstory. If it seemed abrupt kind of getting into that text, let me tell you a little bit of what's going on. You see, Peter and John were, earlier in this day, they were headed up to the temple, going there for a bit of prayer time. And on their way in, there comes this man who's been lame, who's never walked a day in his life. He's laying there at the gate, and he asks them, "Can you help me?" And Peter turns and he looks this man straight in the eye. He looks deep into his soul and he says, "Man, I got no money, but here's what I've got. In the name of Jesus, walk." And this man stands up and he can walk and he can dance and he can praise. And so other people start to see this. And so a crowd begins running up to Peter and John, and this man running up in sheer and utter shock, trying to figure out what is going on here. It's strange, but it's not just strange because it's a miracle. No, it's strange because we never expected something like this out of this guy, Peter. Peter asks them, he says, "Why are you looking at me wide-eyed? Why are you looking all surprised? Like I accomplished this on my own." Now, friends, if you can, I invite you into a little mental exercise. If you can, suspend all of your beliefs, just for a little bit. Suspend all of your beliefs about the Messiah and Jesus and Simon Peter. Suspend everything that you know about who Peter becomes, who the great apostle that he grows into. Suspend everything that you know from looking backwards about what happens with this Jesus movement. Suspend, if you can, everything you know, all your modern Christian understandings, and jump back in time, back into this moment when a lame man is miraculously healed. You see, it was only a few short weeks ago that Jesus, this guy, was crucified. After that, the marginally popular movement seemed to falter and fail and fizzle out. Followers deserted, they denied, they disbanded. Former disciples huddled together behind locked doors or headed home on the road to Emmaus. It seemed to all the bystanders, to all the people who were watching this and observing what was going on, it seemed like those who had crucified him were correct. It seemed like those authorities that had judged him had judged rightly. It seemed like it had been accurate. He was not the real Messiah. And yet here, some no-name disciple of this failed movement, some uneducated fisherman from up north, somebody who's never amounted to much at all in his life, has performed the job of a physician and miraculously made a man walk and jump and run. It was something we never expected. We never saw it coming. Y'all know that we have mental ruts, right? Folks say that back in the 1960s, there used to be a sign along an Alaskan highway at this junction, a sign that read, "Choose your rut carefully. You'll be in it for the next 50 miles." You know, mental ruts are inevitable. As human beings, our minds were created to form natural pathways. Mental ruts are inevitable, and as we move through this world, we will find ourselves traveling in ruts. But what do we do, my friends? What do we do when God shows up outside of those ruts? What do we do when God shows up outside of those who are like us? What do we do when God acts through unexpected individuals with surprising bumper stickers? If you keep following this story in Acts, you learn that there is a split. I encourage you to read it when you get home. You learn that there's a split. And people go one of two different ways. Some folks, they're astonished by this miracle. They can't believe it. And so they choose to take a second look at Peter and at Jesus. They begin following this new move of God. While others recognize that this is a totally unexplained and unexplainable miracle. But they still cling to their initial beliefs. They fight to stop this heresy from spreading. They fight against what God is doing. And so the question for us is, what do we do when we see somebody that conflicts with our preconceived notions? Do we say, well, I just don't get it? Or do we re-examine the rut that we're traveling in? The things that we are believing, the things that we are telling ourselves, do we use it as an opportunity for Christian growth? You know, it's interesting because as Christians, I think we should inherently believe in the unbelievable, right? As Christians, we should expect God to show up in the most unlikely of places. As Christians, we should just assume that God will arrive in somebody that we never, ever anticipated, that God will use the weak to shame the wise, that God will make the last first, that God will turn our world upside down. As Christians, we can use Scripture, text, the Holy Text to remind us of these truths and rescue us out of those ruts. Or we can use Scripture to remain stubbornly where we are. But the big question that separates the disciples from those who misunderstand and those who begin fighting against God is, can we recognize God moving in unexpected people? Do y'all know that Mahatma Gandhi was a lawyer? Mahatma Gandhi was a lawyer who lived very modestly. He wore a loincloth in order to share solidarity with the poor. He employed nonviolent resistance in order to fight for civil rights and for freedom. He battled against poverty. He expanded women's rights in India. He built religious and ethnic bridges across those barriers. He ended untouchability, which was the idea that some were better than others and some others were untouchable. But Christians will often ask, they'll say, well, what about Gandhi? He's not a Christian. Will he be in heaven? My friends, I think we're asking the wrong question. You see, that question betrays a bias that God only works through and with good Christian people. It's why these good Jews missed Jesus, repudiated the Son of God, even crucified, killed the author of life, because He didn't fit within their boundaries. They could not see God in somebody like Jesus or like Peter. But Peter encourages those who would listen. He says, repent. Turn your lives toward God. Move beyond your rut. Stop judging from a limited mindset and be open to the presence of God that is all around you. The presence of God in surprising places. The presence of God in surprising people. Then God can wipe away your sins. God can pour out showers of blessing to refresh your soul and send Jesus Himself into your very midst. My family boarded a crowded trolley in Chicago. At the tail end of a long, long day of a lot of sightseeing, there were no seats left in this whole trolley, and our kids were done. All you parents know exactly what that means, right? Our kids were done, and the parents were done too. But this elderly woman who spoke only Arabic, no English. This woman who was visiting from Egypt, who wore a hijab, she swooped our little curly blonde-headed Ariana up into her lap and cradled her with the love of a grandmother. Friends, can we see God? Are we looking for God in the most unexpected of people? Because, my friends, that's where the power of Jesus moves and heals and reconciles and grows. Amen. Perhaps one of the most beautiful things about this text is that Simon Peter, the preacher, is perhaps the most unlikely of people. He's the one who has denied Jesus. He is the denier in chief. He's the one who was the closest and yet said no. And yet he is welcomed back by Jesus Christ. And he's the one that Jesus uses. And so if you're sitting there going, you know what, I'm just plain old Jane. I'm just plain old Jack. Know that that's exactly who God uses the most powerfully. The unexpected. If you'll give your life to God and say, God, here I am. I don't know what you can do with all this mess, but God can take it and remake it into something beautiful. So that's the opportunity, that's the invitation to turn your life over to God, to say, God, help me to see with new eyes, to see what you can do through me. God, help me to see others with new eyes, to see the beauty in them, that we could be community building the kingdom of God together. For our God is moving and acting whether we see it or not. And I pray that we have eyes to see, hearts to understand, ears to hear, and feet to move where God is calling. If you hear God calling you, I encourage you, come and let's pray together, spend a few moments. If you'd like to give your life to Jesus Christ, this is your opportunity. This is your chance to come, to make a confession of faith, to join this congregation, this family. I invite you to come if you hear that nudge on your heart. Let's all stand and let's sing. Let's lift our voices to God. We have an opportunity today that Innisfree had they apparently had a case of COVID-19 show up, and so please pray for all those folks. I think it's contained, but they're not allowing folks to go in there this weekend. And so we get to have Donna with us. Donna has normally been leading the worship in Innisfree with the folks who come there and taking First Christian Church to them. And so I wanted to take a moment to pray for her in that ministry. You said you wanted to say something? Okay, I'll give you this. Oh, it's not going to work. Come over to the pulpit here. Yes, they'll turn that one on for you.
Hello? Okay. I just want to say what a pleasure it is to see everybody. It's been over a year since I've been in a sanctuary. Last year, January, I was sick. They said it was pneumonia. Then months later, they said it may have been COVID. I spent my whole year not being able to breathe. I still struggle with breathing, but my lungs have gotten better. During that time, my daughter was going through some things, and she didn't want to be here, and she tried to take her life. And I just want to say the church has just been awesome. Even when I tried to walk away, I tried to hide, I tried to let it go. Sean wouldn't turn me loose. You guys kept praying for me. Terry, thank you. Thank you so much for everything that you did, for all of the cards. You never stopped. I just want to say thank you to the people who never gave up on me, even though I gave up on myself. It's been a long, hard road. And I got to the point where I was praying, God, take me home. This is not the life I want to live. If I can't serve you, and I can't breathe, and I can't move, then my time is done. And then he breathed on me, and he gave me strength. And then doors started opening again, and he gave me the opportunity to serve him again. Amen. I stand here today because of him. I stand here today because of the church. I stand here today because of all of you. Amen. Don't ever turn your back on each other. Love one another. And I want to say, social distance, wear your mask, get your vaccine, because even though you don't think that it's affecting you, you may be affecting someone else. We have got to stay together. I think about all of God's people who may have gone on and didn't know him because of COVID, and that just tears me apart. It is our job and our duty to stand for Jesus the same way he stood for us.
Amen. Amen. I invite you, if you would, go ahead, yeah, stay where you are, and just if you want to reach out towards Donna, we love to lay hands on people, but we'll just kind of virtually lay hands right now. And let's pray for Donna as one that we send out. God, we thank you for the gift of life in Donna, for your spirit alive and well within her, for the life that you continue to breathe into her body. We pray, oh God, that you would carry her into Innisfree, that you would go with her, and that your presence would ooze out of her, and others would see the joy, the love, the hope in Jesus Christ through her ministry. God, we pray for all of those who live in Innisfree and for the blessings that they have been, the ways that we stand upon their shoulders, the ways that they defended this country and defended us and helped in so many ways, helped us to grow up and to be who we are called to be. And so God, help Donna and let us reach through Donna to them to be a blessing of love and grace, of peace and stillness in their lives. God, do mighty, matchless things through her and in that space. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, and all of God's people said, amen. God bless you. Thank you. You may be seated.
Amen. God is good. Amen. When Peter said in the scripture, Sean shared with us that it was faith and faith alone that raised that man up, allowed him to walk again. And it's faith and faith alone that allows us to gather at this table to take a little piece of bread and a little cup of juice and allow it to transform us and to change us because of what it represents, because of the love of God that it reminds us of. And so I encourage you here in the sanctuary and at home to prepare your bread and your cup. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your great love, for the power of your forgiveness, for the power of your restoring touch. And so during this time, as we share this bread and this cup and remember your love and sacrifice for us, we ask that you would change us, that you would heal us, that you would ask us to stand up, to walk, to dance, to praise. God, use us as we do this in remembrance of you. Hear these words from the Gospel of Luke. When the hour came, he took his place at the table with the apostles with him. He said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks for it, he broke it. He gave it to them and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's share the bread. And then he took a cup, and after giving thanks for it, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves, for this cup is poured out for you and for many. It is a new covenant in my blood." Let's share. May the God of hope and life continue to restore us and renew us as we continue to serve. Amen.
This morning in our Bible study, we were talking about hope and one of the how hope should change our lives. And one of the verses was in Matthew 6, which talked about where Jesus said, "Where your treasure is, that is where your heart will be." And I was thinking about that. I was thinking about, so where is my treasure, and where is my heart, and the way that I live and the things that I do, does that show everybody else where my treasure is and therefore where my heart is? And I was thinking about this church, and I don't think there's any question as to where the evidence is that the church's heart is, because the church's treasure is given so that others can receive the things that they need here on earth and the things that they need for spiritual help. And there are, as we know, several ways of giving. You can give online, you can give text to give, you can mail in a check to the church. There's an offering plate in the back if you're here to give your offering as well and to indicate where our treasure is and where our heart is. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we thank you that you have given us the desire. You're the one that puts that joy in our heart, that cheerfulness in our heart as we give. We thank you, Father, for that, and we thank you for the way that you continue to multiply those gifts so that others will receive. We pray these in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for giving your life to God in these moments, and I pray that you'll continue to give your life to God in this week ahead as you're given opportunities to shine that light to others. A few things I want to share with you before we go from this time and this place together. We're going to have a deacon slash usher slash greeter training. So if you're a deacon or you're just interested in serving as a greeter, we're going to have a training on Sunday, May 2nd at 11 a.m., so right after the service. If you want to come be a part of that, we would love to have you. Also, if you say, I don't want to come, then we are going to try to, I think we're going to try to Zoom it as well. And so you could watch from home and be a part of that. So let us know in the office if you want that link to do that. Second of all, JYF started meeting this past Sunday. That's for third through fifth graders. So they're meeting on Sundays from 5 to 6:15. There were 10 kids last week. So tons of third through fifth graders, and there still were more that weren't there yet, so come be a part of that. And then also on May 2nd, I want to let you know that you don't want to miss that Sunday because that's going to be Youth Sunday. Our 6th through 12th graders are going to be leading us in worship, and so you will not want to miss that, both the 10 and the 5 o'clock services. And if any 6th through 12th graders are wanting to be a part of that, of leading worship, you're invited to join them Sunday evenings at 5 o'clock. That's when they're doing all their plans, putting it all together. So you can join Ronnie at 5 o'clock until 6:15 on Sunday evenings. I encourage you to wait where you are. Our ushers will dismiss us in just a moment. You can wave at the camera at the back there to say hello to everyone who's worshiping online. If you would, connect yourself to somebody beside you or reach out with your hand or your arms to somebody who's near you, and let's share a blessing as we go from this place. May the Spirit of God be upon you, that you would be a surprising instrument within God's hand, somebody that others never thought would come or speak or preach or act in these ways. Go and be the presence of God and see the presence of God working all around you, working within creation and every human life for goodness, wholeness, completeness. Go and share the good news with all that you meet in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and all of God's people said, Amen.